Fantastic. Welcome to the inaugural Lex Sportiva digital content that we'll be producing today. With me, I've got some fantastic young sports lawyers who have all been involved in setting up their own sports law practice. My name's Justin Humphreys. I'm the founder of Lex Sportiva. I did a sports law master's at ISDE in Madrid, in Spain, and I now work in the case management team at UK Anti-Doping. So again, without further ado, I'll let you introduce yourselves, some of the panel. We'll start with Gilberto.
My name is Gilberto Oliveras. I'm from Puerto Rico. I did a sports law master's at ISDE in Madrid, and I just recently opened my legal practice focused on mainly sports law. So here I am. I think Martin's turn.
All right. Hi, guys. I'm Martin Kiss. I also opened my law firm here in Hungary. And I am actually from Hungary, but I also did my master's actually together with Justin and Gilberto at ISDE Madrid. And it's just a great opportunity to be here and talk about this whole process and what we've been through.
Fantastic.
Well, I'll jump in there. Hi, guys. I'm Shane Wafer. I'm a practicing attorney from South Africa. Unfortunately, I'm one of the few that hasn't done the ISDE Masters, not yet. It's on my bucket list, but I'm currently studying a practice management diploma at the University of New York. My sports law firm is Javelin Sports Consulting. I started it with another ISDE partner, my partner Jan Nau. Thanks so much for having me today, Justin.
You're very welcome. Santiago?
Well, my name is Santiago Zambrano. I also did the master's on international sports law from ISDE in Madrid. I did it in 2018. I have 2 years since I came back to Guayaquil, Ecuador. I opened my own law firm also. So it's glad to see that a lot of people try to do their own place because, well, sports law is a new industry. There's a lot of places to cover. So I'm very glad to be sharing this opportunity with you.
Fantastic. Well, welcome all of you. The first thing that I really want to get to understand is some of the motivations behind setting up on your own. Obviously, it's a kind of well-trodden path to go and work for a already established law firm. So I just wanted to hear maybe from some of you what your motivations were, why you decided to set up on your own, and what the stages of the process had been like, especially at the start.
I'll take that one. I did my master's with Justin and Martin, and I went to work with Santiago after my master's to do the internship and stay there till February. So when I came back, I had a job lined up. I was supposed to start working sports law. I came back in March, obviously coronavirus. And I know that you wanted to ask about the coronavirus later, Justin, but I'll tell you right now. Coronavirus, I lost obviously the job opportunity I had. So I decided that it was the best time to just structure everything and start my own law firm. And I learned a lot in ISDE. I learned a lot more when I was with Santiago. So I just decided that it was the perfect moment since all the knowledge was fresh. So I decided to just get everything together, start working. And through a couple of connections I have, I was able to get a few contracts, a few good clients, and it's been going great since then. So
I'll get on that as well, because this is something that I wanted to mention. And I don't know if this is the dimension you want to approach, but what I've experienced was that, coming from Europe and being in the European market, you know, this is a market that's quite established in sport with big agents, big clubs, you know, big agencies. And by agencies, I also mean law firms. And so after the master, I've had 2 internships lined up, but for various reasons, I couldn't do it. And I came back to Hungary. And what I found is that Eastern European markets are not that open to international sports lawyers, or specifically sports lawyers. And there's one that I know here who's actually lectured at ISDE for the first time this year. And he's a Hungarian lawyer who's told me that he finds it very difficult to actually break into the Hungarian market and to put any influence on teams, because what they end up doing here in this Eastern European region, still it's about basically who you know, who's your friend. You know, you have your own in-house lawyer that's your friend from high school, and but they don't have the experience with international practice and sports law. And so another friend of ours, Divi Kadakia from our master, mentioned that he had a case against the Hungarian team, and the Hungarian lawyer was very unprepared, wasn't ready. And that was the point that kind of told me that, look, there is a chance. And with a couple of fortunate meetings with friends of mine who work in sport, it turns out that there is a need for lawyers like this. People just don't know about it. They don't know that sports law is a new field. So after having set it up, just another brief on how I actually set it up. I started it as a sole proprietor, you know, as a sole individual. So I just invoice people, and actually the company is currently being prepared, but we're just waiting for the capital to be input so that it becomes an actual company. But in terms of Hungarian law, you can also do it as a sole proprietor. So there's no issue in that.
Very nice. And perhaps we'll go to you, Shane. Would you just like to explain Javelin Sports a bit more, where it's based and when you set it up?
Sure. Thanks, Justin. Look, from my side of things, it initially started straight out of university. My partner and I can give a lot of thanks to our mentors at the university at the time that guided us in this direction. They informed us the market here in South Africa is quite small. And in fact, in Africa, it's quite small compared to South America, America and Europe. So he sort of pushed us in that direction. Initially, it wasn't viable for us to start straight out of university. So I set up my initial practice and then parked that. And I got a little bit more experience in the commercial side of things at an established law firm. Jan then went overseas and did his master's. And when he came back, we decided, look, now or never, let's start this. Let's see what we can do. And then Javelin Sports Consulting was born, essentially. And it's been great ever since. Look, we started in 2017. Of course, there's been hiccups and it's been really hard work. But in hindsight, I think it was the right thing to do. Coming straight out of university, it can be tough. And a lot of students will look at it and say, how did you do it? And the pressures and, how did you get clients? And what's it like setting up your own firm? You pay your own bills and you hire people. And there's a lot of stress that comes with it. But at the same time, I think that stress drives you. And that urge and that need to be successful is what eventually makes you successful. I wouldn't look back now. If you took me back 3 years, I would do the same thing. I'd make the same mistakes. I'd meet the same people. I wouldn't change anything. I think that's what gets you to the final. It's not the destination; it's the path walked, they say. But it's been a fantastic journey. Sports law is a very nuanced field, as was touched on earlier. It's very new. And there's not so many practicing attorneys right now that I think the market is overcrowded. Some would suggest it is, but I don't think there's enough good sports attorneys out there, not to speak down on anyone.
I second that.
The attorneys. But there's a lot of room for improvement. And I think given the fact that a lot of us are quite young coming into the market, it's good that we're all staying connected and we're communicating with each other and we're developing a good network, which is essential in my opinion for establishing a law firm. So, kudos to you, Justin, and what you've done at Lex Sportiva and Martin and Santiago. And, we've all put ourselves out there, and I think has a lot to do with, the success that's come our way.
So Shane, yeah, you talk about kind of putting yourself out there, and in some ways that involves advertising your expertise. And I know a lot of you are involved in writing and a lot of you are involved in social media. And you kind of touched on that question just now about a lot of students would ask you, how do you get clients? So I was wondering, Santiago, how do you advertise your experience in order to get clients?
Well, basically here in Ecuador, it has been very straightforward. I mean, you go direct to the client and say, look, this is my background. This is where I come from. Also, it happens that, as Gilberto said, you need to have some relationship, build some relationship. And there are a lot of situations that will take you to this point. I mean, my father is vice president of the Ecuadorian Olympic Committee. He knows some people. One time I played football or badminton because I used to play badminton. And now I'm the lawyer of the Pan American Badminton Confederation. So it has to be with some a very interesting percentage of luck of build something before that will take you now to have the opportunity to knock that door and say, okay, look, this is
this is who I am, this is what I'm doing, so let me in. In Ecuador, as I believe Shane was saying, it's also, or Martin, it was Martin, right?
Yeah.
I still don't know you, all of you.
That's okay.
Okay, so it's a place where you have to knock the door a couple of times so they can finally open it. And Gilberto was here. We approached to different federations, to different clubs. A lot of them will open the doors and say, look, come help us. And on the others will say, as Martin was saying, look, I already have my lawyer, which is my friend from high school, which is my nephew, which is a political favor that I have to pay. So it's a little bit complicated, but it's also, I would say in some clubs it's complicated, in other clubs it's very easy. Thank God I was working, I'm working with two first division clubs, with a big institution such as Badminton Confederation, but when Gilberto was here, we knocked the door for Ecuadorian Basketball Federation for 5 months, and we never received the opportunity to work with them. So it's a little bit difficult sometimes. You have to be very persistent. You have to be confident with what you're doing. As I told Gilberto when he came, we are the same age. So when he came, Gilberto and Anida, I told them, look, I'm not going to teach you anything. I'm just going to give you the confidence so you can go and have a meeting by yourself. And when I was discussing this with him, when he opened his own law firm, he told me, yeah, now I feel very, I believe in myself to do that. And it's something that is not always you're going to be, it's not something you will get in a big sports law office. Because I was there in Hamburg, in Germany. It was a great opportunity, but it's not this opportunity that they will give you the keys of the office and say, okay, look, this is your moment, go and shine.
And you talk about perseverance and confidence being important qualities in order to kind of set up on your own and feel that you can go and meet those clients and have those meetings one-on-one and feel confident in your ability. Maybe Gilberto or Martin, are there any other qualities that you can think of that have helped you along the way or have been crucial to setting up on your own?
I think the fact that I love what I do and I'm willing to do it for free, even though I'm getting paid for it, is essential, because I started out doing work for free. Like when I started, and we were talking about this before we started the webinar or the chat, I'm working for the anti-doping organization, and they don't pay me. This is basically ad honorem. We're doing this for free. We're doing this for the betterment of the sport. But I love what I'm doing. This is my favorite part of every day, waking up and doing the anti-doping things. So I think the fact that I love what I'm doing, if you love what you do, you won't be working, and you'll be good. You'll be great at it.
Yeah, I think what I'd add to that is obviously people underestimate how much work goes into it and how much stress, because you know a lot of times what you're doing is, I also work for TechBalt running their anti-doping and sport integrity, basically drafting all the regulations that will guide the sport. And so what you do is you might have a 9-to-5, and then you have your own law firm, and then what we'll do is you'll work for them, you know, work through nights. You know, my girlfriend probably would be able to give a couple answers of how difficult it is when I'm always on my phone, where I'm yesterday we were shopping at Tesco, and then an agent called me and said, yes, can you send the contract of the player to the FA, and can you do this? And so it's a lot of perseverance, but it's also just knowing that at the end of the day you'll get to that target. Like, you know, Gilberto said, you know, you're willing to do work for free, and I did a lot of things in the beginning, since basically September when I was doing it on my own. I worked for free until about end of February for this agency, and then I said, okay, you know, it's about time we set a fee for things. So that's just a bunch of months, and that's something that, you know, you have to do, you have to go through it. And I think when someone talks about setting up your firm or getting clients, one thing that you have to know is, I always say, fake it till you make it. And in that, I don't mean that you should fake your knowledge or fake that you're a lawyer. What I'm saying there is just show that you're ready, that you're there, you know, believe in yourself, and then eventually when it arrives, you're gonna feel like it was the easiest thing ever.
And definitely I can weigh in there too, as Gilberto, sorry if my pronunciation is wrong, and Martin touched on. is I think a lot of people that get into the industry forget the fact that not all clients are rolling in cash, and they're not all available, you know, to pay you at all times. I do a lot of pro bono work for clients, and that leads to more work. I can't speak more of what word of mouth will do for your career and your reputation. You do work for five pro bono clients, and you'll get one big ticket client that might set you up for the next couple of months, and that might finance other projects you do. So I don't be scared to assist clients on a pro bono basis. Not only will you learn, there'll be less risk attached to the work you do. And I truly believe that word of mouth will eventually get out there, and the work you do for people will get noticed. And then, like I said, those big ticket clients will come. I mean, that's the beauty about sports law, is a massive doping matter, or a massive matter that leads to CAS, is, I'm sure, as most of you know, it costs a lot of money. And one or two big clients can really set you up and help facilitate the rest of your firm.
I think that's something I just want to quickly add on, is I think Shane is very right there, that this agency that I mentioned, when they started out last year, April, so that's why I worked for them for free in the beginning. And what they ended up noticing was that, you know, for me, it wasn't necessarily about the money, and I was willing to go that distance. And now they have complete trust in me, and I really do appreciate that. And I think when you have that relationship with someone, you're doing something more than just work. And I, the case that I have now, the way that happened also is I found out that the lawyer that was trusted wasn't a sports lawyer, but he upfront said he wants 500 euros for a termination letter. And then when they came to me, I said, well, you know, let's see what I can do, and we'll get to it. And automatically the first thing the agent said was, wow, I've had 5 minutes on the phone with you and you haven't talked about money. And I guess it just showed his experience with previous lawyers. So that's again, going back to the type of person you are, and that you reflect that in your work.
I want to add also, Gilberto had the opportunity to negotiate also, or at least be next to me when we were negotiating some fees. It's a hard moment, because this is not something that they will teach you at the university. This is not something that you will discuss even with your friends. I mean, I'm pretty sure that you went to get a coffee at ISDE, or have a beer, or have vegetarian food with Gilberto. But this is not something you will talk and say, okay, how can we do it to get some money? What is the correct price? In most of our countries, such as Puerto Rico, Hungary, in South Africa, in Ecuador, it's not something that you have a comparative scheme to say, okay, if this big lawyer of sports law used to charge $1,000 per hour, I will charge $500. It's not something that you have, so you have to start learning while you're working. Sometimes you will say, man, this was too easy and I get a lot of money. And in the other time, you will say, this was too hard and I didn't charge enough. And in other cases, you will say, I didn't charge anything for this. But it's also the opportunity to say, okay, I'm working, I'm learning. There are, in some cases, you will say, I'm being paid for something that I love. I'm being paid for learning, for trying to find a way. So, that's something that you will have to also learn and try to put your price. Say, okay, this is what I can, this is what I need for living. The cost of living, it also depends on where you're living. Ecuador is very, very cheap. Gilberto knows. You can get lunch for $7-$8. In a very good place. I mean, and if you want to have a regular lunch, you will have to pay $2. So that's something that puts you a range of money to say, okay, I want to eat in the place of maybe $20. Yeah, there is a couple of them. So then you try to say, okay, this is what I need to charge. What are the costs of my office so I can make it profitable? Then in some cases you have to go, you want to go to a congress, so what, how much is for the congress to go with your girlfriend? I know, Martin, you have your girlfriend. She's sacrificing some things, but in exchange of that also, in as a couple, you're trying to build something. Okay, so it's I also have my girlfriend. I've been working next to her. She was watching Netflix. I was working on my phone. We were eating. I had to run to get something for the client. So it's very sacrificing and demanding, but it's also very, it fulfills you in a very in different ways.
Yeah, you kind of touch on that, the effect that running your own business has on your work-life balance. I was just wondering whether any of the rest of you have had a similar experience where, you know, it's different to a 9-to-5 job. When it's your business, it's much more personal. And, you know, it rides on you. And are you more involved? How do you feel about it? It's maybe you have some kind of emotional connection to it. So how do you feel about it?
Yeah, I heard a quote once that it's when you have your own business, it's not 9-to-5. It's when you open your eyes, you close your eyes. And it's true. Like I open my eyes, it's work. I close my eyes. I've been working all day. I sit down with my family to eat. I have my phone next to me. I check my phone. It's all day, every day, but it's not work. It's something you like, and it's something you do because you like it. And it might take a toll on you sometimes. Like Saturdays you're working, Sundays you're working, every hour you're working, you have your phone, you got to check your phone, you got to make sure you don't have a client. But I think it does take a toll in your personal life, but you're enjoying it so much you don't realize it.
I mean all of us, I never let myself forget this, that I think something we leave out a lot of the discussion is a lot of the people we look up to, they've been in the industry for years, 30, 40 plus years, and they didn't become successes overnight. I mean, the majority of us graduated, let's say, in the last 5 years. Now, we started our own firms, we're working hard, we're working 9-to-5s, but so is everyone else. And those people that you're competing with have been doing 9-to-5s or 6-to-6s or 18-hour days for the last 30 years. And I think that's what we need to remember, is that we're all in this slog together, and eventually it will pay off. We're still young. We're still in the infancy phases of our business. So don't forget that everyone is in the same position as you. I think what a lot of us forget is that we're all in the same boat. We all have the same issues. We like to think that we don't, but we all have the same stresses, the same worries about clients paying and how we're going to pay for the bills and when is the next work coming and are we going to be successful in this case. If we all realize that, I think we all struggle with the same problems, I think it becomes a lot easier.
Well, I think the two things I'd add to that is, on the one hand, since this is your life and what you're doing, one thing is that you shouldn't be afraid to ask for help. So, I mean, one guy that's helped me quite a bit, and then initially I was a little bit worried and I wouldn't believe when he said, you know, feel free to just message me about anything, was one of the founders of Sila Lawyers, Georgi Gradev. He from Bulgaria, and he gave us a class that he's there as well. And he told me the story when he called me about something here in Hungary. I helped him, and then he said, you know, feel free to ask me. And he told me the story that he was going through the same thing, you know. He was with a couple of friends, they started it, and then now they have offices, I think, in like 6 countries. So it's crazy, but it did take, you know, 15 years. So it, you don't start from nothing. And just going back to the personal, what I would add to what Gilberto said is you will go through that. There's no way to avoid it. The only thing you have to learn, and I'm still learning, is sometimes to be able to say no to either clients or people that are bothering you. You know, you have to have a limit on your personal life and be able to say, look, I'm not available for a call at 9. Of course, if it's necessary and important, you do it. But it's the same thing that I've sent an email today to the agent of the club who's negotiating for the player with us so that we settle outside of FIFA. I sent him the email and I said, look, I'm not available for the rest of the day, but feel free to call me even Saturday or Sunday and we can discuss it and I'll find time for it. And what you'll find is that because you're doing this not as a job, but kind of like your lifestyle, you'll find it that every little bit where you say no or you don't do it, that it's going to damage your career in the long run, you know. So that's something that I've had to learn from the start.
So something you both touched on there really is the importance of having mentors or people in the business to look up to. Martin, you mentioned Georgi Gradev, and Shane, you mentioned that there was, you know, you talked about other people who have been in the industry for 30 years. So were mentors important for you in setting up on your own? Maybe we'll go to Gilberto for this one.
They were the key to me starting my own practice. I have Santiago. Santiago helped me a lot. I also have a friend of mine here, the president of the anti-doping organization. He's a friend of mine. He was my mentor ever since I graduated law school. And surprisingly, or not surprisingly, Luis Pamplona from ISDE has been super helpful with everything I'm doing. He messages me every other week, like, hey, how's it going? Do you need help with anything? So I think all those, at least those three people, and probably many more, have given me the confidence to just go out and do it. If it wasn't for them, I'd probably be like, no, I'll just wait for the COVID thing to be over and just start working for anyone. Because I wouldn't be confident in doing it. But those two people, and Santiago's here, he can tell you how much he's helped me. So I think those two people were instrumental for me to do it.
I'll say...
Santiago, go for it.
Okay, thank you. Well, adding also about the people that can help you, it's not always it's not someone higher. I mean, it's not like a teacher from us. It's not someone can also be a friend, such as Gilberto when he came. Then you try or Ida when she came, or the other paralegal that has come here. They're very important also, so you can grow up immediately. I mean, you have your mentor, as we were saying, that he will give you some guides. But surprisingly, in some cases, it's the people that come under you, but not under you. I mean, that comes after you, I would say, that will teach you a lot more. They are, maybe they will help you to give you some tips. They are in some cases younger. They know other things. They have a different perspective of things. So I would say in both ways, if either you have your mentor that it's supposed to be above you, and then your friends, someone that will look up to you. Here in Ecuador, there are a lot of people that want to do sports, so, and they will be texting us to the Instagram. They will come to the office. They will call you and say, I heard from you on the radio, on the TV, on Instagram. I'm very interested in what you're doing. I want to do the same. So that gives you also an extra motivation. So it's either way, and it depends on how you receive this information.
I agree with you so much, Santiago, especially with respect to a colleague. And now in my case, that's exactly the situation. Is I don't believe I would have been able to be where I am today if it wasn't for my colleague. Now, Jan and I set up Javelin together, and for the very reason that you need someone to bounce ideas off, you need someone to run concepts by, you need someone to ask that stupid question so that maybe you can take that stupid question once he's confirmed it isn't so stupid to your mentor. And, you know, you can chat about things during the day. Is this all right? Or do you think I should maybe attach this as another annexure to the submissions? Or and you together, you grow together, I think. And it's very important, I think, to get across to the listeners that it's not about yourself. It's a team effort. And when I say team, it's about the people that are around you. You know, the secretary at your offices, whoever does the research for you. Without them and without the team, it wouldn't be possible for you to become successful. So I think I give a lot of credit to the people you have around you. I do, certainly. And I definitely wouldn't be here if it wasn't for my partners and my mentors and my colleagues.
You go, Martin. You can go.
No, I just so what I'd add quickly is the partners, definitely, that for me, you know, I work with Divi and Andre, and they're the two guys who've, you know, Divi on the one hand was the guy who always pushed that let's do something, but he needed, I think, at least from my view, he may disagree, but I think he needed my organization to put the ideas organized and get started. And then with Andre, we talked a lot over the whole summer and his dreams and goals, and so I think I gave that emotional support that we can do it, and he gave me the professional support. And with the three of us, what means a lot to me is that even in our first case now, when something comes up that says, oh my God, you know, what if we messed up here? You know, we send something that won't work and we mess it up. We fail together. And that kind of gives you that comfort that you know you're in this with other people. And it just, you also get a hope that, okay, you know, if you make a mistake, then at the next point we do it together and we do it better. And if you were doing it all alone and you wouldn't have the mentors or the partners, then you wouldn't take those risks. that are necessary for you to actually move forward in things.
Definitely.
Yeah. I like to add to that, because the whole point of the partners, and I'm a sole practitioner, I work by myself, but I think the whole, like, so having an equal that you can bounce ideas off of is one of the biggest things that I got from ISDE, is that we have people that we can count on. Like, I probably, Santiago has mentioned Ida like 4 times, and I go to Ida if I need help with anything. Like, I don't know how to do this. Can you help me out? This is IP law. You're a better IP law than me. Or I'll go to Divi and ask him, do you have an agent? Or I have a player that needs an agent. Can you do this? So I have, like, I mentioned mentors before, but I really think that colleagues and people that are your equals in law and in the practice are essential as well, even for solo practitioners myself.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
We talked a lot about the kind of benefits of collaboration to your own business kind of from within. I'm just wondering how collaboration works between law firms. I know you, Martin, and you, Shane, have got this partnership together. I'm just wondering how important kind of international connections are, or affiliations, or kind of relationships are with other law firms, and how that's impacted your business.
Look, I'll just touch on it briefly. I think one of the benefits of collaboration is access to information. Now, the beauty of the relationship I have with Martin and his firm is that if a client picks up the phone in Europe and he needs something done in Africa, or he needs a claim filed in Africa, instead of him having to then go Google someone or attempt to find someone's name, he then can instruct Martin to pick up the phone to me, and it allows us to stress across the continents and provide, very importantly, our clients with the ability to gain knowledge from persons outside of your jurisdiction and within your jurisdiction. I think the key word is access to information. Educating our clients is vitally important. And if we can do that through each other's platforms and gain traction for each other, all the better.
Yeah. Also, Gilberto knows, ISDE is a very good place to get connections. One friend of him, text him about some things in Ecuador relating to sports law. He make the connection. Because of coronavirus, it has stopped, but it will probably move on forward. I mean, but it's very important. I've been talking with my own professors, big ones, in Switzerland, in Germany, in Spain. Then you have your friends also. I hope in a moment I can do something in Puerto Rico. Let's see, because we don't have very good basketball players or baseball players. We tend to be very short. But let's see. Let's see if something will happen. Guys, I'm very sorry, but I have to go. We were discussing about the things that we have to run up in any moment. So this is one of the moments. This is the practical thing that we were discussing in some moments ago. So I have to run for a client, but it has been very nice to see you, to meet you finally, put a face on all of you. Nice to see you again, Gilberto, and I hope to see you after all this happens. And I will be looking forward to hear more from you.
Thank you very much, Santiago.
Bye bye, take care.
Bye, take care.
Well, there we go. That's a first-hand example of clients coming first, and the work, you know, comes at all times of day. And he briefly mentioned coronavirus there. Obviously, very important topic. It's impacted the way I work, for sure. I imagine it's also impacted your businesses as well. Can you kind of just briefly explain some of the changes that you've seen, and whether actually some of those changes have been positive to the way you work? That's what I've found in some aspects. What do you guys think?
I'll start with an example that I've had was basically getting a player to figure out how to sign documents with him being in another country because of COVID and not coming back to Hungary to play. And it was negative in the way that at first I thought that this is annoying, that I have to teach him how to do things, but then he managed to learn and do it. And he had a very positive response to me because of the way that I've helped him and took him under my wings. So I think that was kind of nice, in that even under COVID, some of the clients have felt that we're still there for them and that we'll get a way done and things aren't falling through. And what was also nice is the ability that you were able to actually show people that you can do things from away. So the agency I work here with Hungary, they always thought that everything always has to be on paper, that electronic copies and signatures don't work. And I even showed them that the Hungarian FA allows you to hand in electronically signed documents. So I think what was good in this is that clients were able to learn that life doesn't stop even in the world that they mostly do things physically.
And from my side of things, both good and bad, I think one of the bad aspects of it is, and this is just amongst us lawyers, is I think it's given license for our clients to break that work social life barrier a little bit more. You might get more phone calls now after hours. You might get emails after hours, because I think the client thinks, look, he's working from home all day anyway, so what's the harm in me sending him an email after hours? But at the same time, I think the benefit of COVID-19 is that we have greater access to each other and to the greater public and clients by virtue of the fact that previously, in my opinion, prior to COVID-19, it would be very difficult, for example, to make contact with an agency or a club. Mm-hmm. They'd prefer to meet in person, or as we touched on earlier, if you have a connection and then you can be associated with that club through that connection, that would be the only way you would maybe achieve work through that entity. But now you can pick up the phone, or you can do a Zoom call, or you can send an email, and the chances that person will look at that email or answer your call are a lot greater now, you know, as we are all moving to a more digital future.
And I guess in some ways social media has become more important as well, and creating content as well. Hilberto, I know Oliveras Legal are very active on their social media, posting interesting facts of the day or interesting cases. Do you want to talk about why that's an approach that you use, and whether that's coronavirus inspired?
No, actually, so the reason why I went into sports law, and we can touch upon that a little bit more later, is because I feel that there's a lack of knowledge on all parties, lawyers, as well as athletes, as well as clubs, federations, everyone has a little lack of knowledge of what it is to actually, we do in sports law, and what aspects of sports are important to different people or different parties in sports. So I started my law firm thinking I'm going to educate people. This is what I want to do. I want to educate. And so I decided that my website is going to be accessible. It's going to be easy to read. It's going to have information for everyone. I'm going to try to post daily so people can have access to different cases or recent cases, can have access to ebooks on intellectual property and stuff like that, so that people are well informed when it comes time to make a decision. I mean, I'd love it if they hire me, but they don't have to hire me. You know what I mean? They can definitely do the things on their own if they're well informed. And at some point, I hope they'll think of me if they need it. But the whole point was to just educate. And that's why I actually started our own podcast here on Sports Law. We're on episode 3, I think. And it's all part of our mission to just educate and have people be well informed about sports and sports.
I want to comment on that. Actually, Hilberto's post, I really do like them. and it kind of shows... you know, himself in it. So what I like in that is that Hilberto's taken the opportunity to show who he is in his way. And with Shane, what I loved is, after having a couple of calls, is I know that education and the materials is very important for him as well. And I think that's one of the reasons why we're having this call, and we're kind of a bit similar here, is that we're all believe in that we have to educate, and that sometimes when you share something, it's not about getting the client or making money off it or the likes. It's about making sure that information is out there in as many means as possible. And I still, you know, talk about it on a daily basis. I had this talk with Andre yesterday saying that I think FIFA should do more about youth players. And he said, how can they do it? And I said, well, maybe a couple of mandatory education sessions from youth categories in academies from 12 to 16 about before the first professional contract, what they have to take care of in terms of anti-doping, you know, about kids who are starting out and they might make their first Olympics at 16. Then you have to tell them, like, look, if your head hurts and you go to your mom, she can't give you that Advil or whatever. So it's just these little things. And I think social media is a great thing for that, especially nowadays, how fast it's growing and how kids, you know, they're on TikTok. So if any of you come up with the first TikTok for anti-doping lessons, then I'm all in that. But
good idea, Martin.
But no, it definitely is important.
And I like to see social media, on there's two sides of the coin. When it comes to Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, I think that social media platform provides you access to clients and to the general public. And in that way, you can educate them with respect to what is doping and how to look at a contract. And then on the other side of the coin, LinkedIn, for example, in my opinion, is a social media platform that provides you access to your peers and your colleagues and possibly even your mentors. And what you can gain from that is I think Justin mentioned the word earlier, content. And content is king. And it has been like that since the day social media started. And it will be like that until the day social media, is no longer there, probably never. But I think putting yourself out there is essentially a free marketing tool. Clients can see, okay, they understand what doping is. You should understand what doping is, of course. But I think it provides them a little bit of credibility. And then on LinkedIn, I think sharing knowledge and information with your colleagues allows you to develop a network. I mean, don't ever think that you won't get work from other colleagues. You never know. You might get a matter because a colleague has too much on his plate, or he thinks you may be better at it than him, or you're in a different jurisdiction. So I think putting yourself out there will reap rewards at a later stage. That's how what I found in my case. I can't speak more highly about social media and the access it's given me to both clients and mentors and colleagues.
Actually, to bring up something is that the first time I wrote to Javelin was through Instagram, and it's because of that someone liked them and I looked at them and I loved the content and I said, look, I really like these guys and I want to work with them. So look, that's a perfect example there.
And 10 years ago, Martin, that wouldn't have been possible.
Yeah.
You would probably have to pick up the phone and I don't know, yellow book us, or maybe not 10 years ago, 20 years ago. But
And imagine where I would get a South African phone book.
Exactly. Right? And I mean, the beauty about this is we're talking from four continents right now. I mean, that wouldn't have been possible a while ago. So it's really the time is now to put yourself out there.
Yeah.
And do you think that's changed because of coronavirus as well? It's kept us all indoors. You mentioned earlier, Shane, that it's actually easier to get a hold of people because, you know, everyone's available and they're at home, and the responses to emails is much more, more on it, and you're more likely to get a response. So do you think that's changed in the coming, in the former few months? And do you think that'll continue when we all go back to the office? Do you think we'll be able to still have those connections and use social media the way it's used now to share as much content and interact online?
I don't think it's changed so much as it was ready for change. I think prior to COVID-19, we were probably on the precipice of the digital age. A lot of people were scared to take that leap into social media and to get themselves out there and to work from home. I speak for myself, but I think a lot of companies have realized work from home is a very viable possibility now for everyone. And I don't think we were ready prior to COVID-19, purely because people, it was untested. It was untested what it would be like to move into a more digital space. But going forward, I think it showed us that it's very possible, and this is the way the way of the world. This is how the future is going. Globalization, is unstoppable. And I think now that everyone's seen that the system will work and people are more comfortable with it, it'll grow from strength to strength. Another issue I think a lot of people have, and I speak for myself again, is people don't realize that it's difficult to put yourself out there. You don't know how many views a post will get, or you don't know who will see a post or a video. You could be in front of 1 million people or 100 people. Either way, it's difficult to put yourself out there. And once you've done that, you realize it wasn't so bad after all. But taking that leap is the important step.
Yeah, that's so right. Obviously, with Lex Sportiva, we've been trying to encourage people to write for us. It's a kind of a safe space for people to experiment and to put their content out there, so that it can be kind of peer reviewed and published. And for a lot of people, they find it difficult to find that platform to express themselves or to show their expertise. So that's what we've been about for the last year and a half. And we've had lots of positive reactions, and we're able to kind of monitor the interactions that we've got, and we've got all these statistics on who's reading what and from where. And I think one of the most encouraging signs is that we've got about 35 contributors now from 16 or 17 different nations, and we've been read in over 150 countries. And it's, you know, when we talk about the power of social media, it just shows how global it really is, how we've got viewers in Trinidad and Tobago and all sorts of places that I've never been to. And it's just brilliant to know that everyone's kind of unified by the same content and by the same passion, which is the growing sector of sports law.
Exactly. If you don't mind me interrupting, I'd just like to take a moment also to talk about Lex Sportiva as someone who's not you, who's the founder, that actually I remember when you started it and how fast it grew and what it became. And I think that's part of the example that you just, you know, okay, I know this is not a Nike commercial, but just do it, because if you won't, you won't get anywhere. But also that what you've done is you've given a platform for people like us who are young people starting their career to show that they are intelligent and that they do know what they're talking about, and then showcase that in a professional way. So I think this video also is a great example of what we can start if we start working together, which I don't know if I'm encroaching on another topic, but that's something that I'd also want to mention, that the big experience I've had is that in this day and age and in this market, what you have to understand is perhaps you shouldn't be looking at becoming the next creative artist agency or the next big company. What you should be looking at is working together with others anywhere in the world that you can and becoming a big group so that you can help each other anywhere. And if you do that, then you'll both get paid. So you will all make money, you'll all be successful, and you do it together. And I know this sounds cheesy, but I think that's what globalization has done. You cannot have a monopoly on a market, you know, because then what you'll do is you'll constantly find yourself fighting off competition. So, and again, I think Lex Sportiva had a big impact on how we were able to connect with each other.
I agree with that. Actually, Lex Sportiva was probably my first opportunity to get out there and talk about sports law. And I think that helped me to just be able to transition what I'm doing now. I wrote, I think, 3 articles for Justin when I was in ISDE in 2019. And straight from that, I launched my law firm now in 2020, and I'm writing every day and posting content and doing that. I think it was just easier to do since I had the platform from before, and just I had already, my fear was already gone. I was ready to do it. And so props, Justin.
Well, yeah, and on that vein, for anyone watching, feel free to get in touch with me if you'd like to get involved with the project, as these guys have done. Fantastic. Well, thank you all very much for sharing some of your ideas, your experiences, the challenges you faced in setting up on your own. It's been great to hear from you, especially having all the different international angles, and with Santiago dropping in and out. It's been really interesting to hear your different perspectives. And as you mentioned, education's incredibly important, especially for you, Martin, and you, Shane, as well, are involved. And this is just a tool for that, really. It's a way for us to network, but it's also a way to discuss and learn about different areas of sports law. And perhaps you'd like to be involved in future sessions that we do, maybe on more specific topics in sports law. But it's been great to get you all together. And thank you for anyone watching this. Thank you very much for watching and for supporting our content. And we hope we can provide more useful content for you in the future, whether you're a law student, whether you're an aspiring sports lawyer, or whether you're a practitioner at the moment, and whether that'll give some people the confidence to go out and set up on their own, I don't know, but I hope it's given them a flavor of what life is like on the other side.
And feel free to reach out to any of us. I think we're all more than willing to give you any tips and pointers if you want. If you're in my side of the world, if you're in their side of the world, just feel free to reach out. And Justin, thank you very much for this opportunity.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Justin.
And I'll stop the recording there.